Thank you, Doug. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Welcome, everybody. I'm Brian Morgan. Can they hear you? Or just thumbs up?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just seeing if you watch the video. Okay. Somebody might have got that one. Okay, two people. Good. Is everybody ready? Brian's going to give you the instructions. I'm just going to say hello. As much as we call it the critical nature of boiler chemistry, we're not talking chemistry. Because you guys all had lunch, right? I don't want you going to sleep in a chemistry lesson. But we are going to be a little more interactive than normal. And so the only chemistry we're giving you is H2O, because we are talking about water. So we're going to try and separate some truths. And to get you started, here's your first test. Man walks into a bar, says, I'll have some H2O. The man next to him says, I'll have some H2O too, please. He drinks it and dies. Okay, you guys aren't scientists. This is the number one science joke on the internet.
All right, well, I'll take it over from here, Jeff, and what we're going to be doing is talking about some myths and some facts. So we're going to be testing you in the audience today to see if you know the statement we're going to put up on the screen, whether it's a myth or a fact. And the reason we're having this session is because there's a big problem in our industry as we've started putting more and more and more condensing boilers into the market. They do a number of great things for us, but if they're not managed properly, we can run into a lot of problems as well. So I know there's a lot of you out there, so I mean, you know, maybe this can be your yes, this can be your no, but I mean, like, how many contractors out there have had a boiler fail, and you're thinking, you want to know what? Could have been a problem. And then you go, don't worry. I put tons of boilers in for these guys. They're going to warranty it for sure. Anyone? Any green? No one? Well, the thing we're finding is that the boiler manufacturers are starting to put way more language into their manuals and doing way more testing than what they're looking at for those heat exchangers to determine whether or not they are, in fact, warranty. So, what we're going to be doing today is going through and talking about some of those myths or facts. But as I said, we're putting in this new technology, this new condensing technology. Does anyone know how long condensing technology has been around? Any guesses? Since the 80s, we hear? Let's get one mic. Okay, anyone else? Like, this was groundbreaking stuff for us in like the early 2000s, putting in condensing boilers. Does anyone know the company that actually started condensing technology? The first patent for condensing technology was to an employee of Rheem in 1974. So we're sitting here 48 years later, and we're still figuring out things to make sure we're doing everything properly. Okay? So we're going to get into the presentation now. We're going to start. So I need a little participation because it's going to help us. But this is our first myth or fact. All boiler heat exchangers can fail. It's kind of a lob ball. We think, green, 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 green. No reds. Well, that's a great start because you're absolutely correct. Now, heat exchangers on all boilers will fail eventually when they're not properly maintained. And there's two ways they're going to fail. They could fail on the fire side, which is what we're showing here, okay? Or they can fail on the water side. So therefore, when we're looking at boiler chemistry, it's very, very important that we look at both sides, the water side and the combustion side, to make sure we're managing the chemistry of what's coming in, going through this equipment and coming out of this equipment. Because when we look at it, it doesn't matter whose exchanger it is, what it's made of, all different materials are out there, stainless steel, aluminum, copper primary, stainless steel secondary, okay? They all look great when they're brand new. And in order to keep them looking that way, there's a few things you gotta do to make sure you maintain them.
All right, next one. Black water or black gold? Is it good for your boiler? Yes? No? You guys seen this before? That's
got
too
a couple
right.
Of both ways.
We're
okay.
Really just kind of lobbing it. So iron oxides and magnetite are the dark particles of rust and corrosion that take place in every hydronic system. And I don't care what your carbon-based fuel is. And yes, water heaters see it too. And I'm sure you guys have seen it. So they're heavier than water. They tend to fall in fire tube design. It's not a high flow area. They're going to deposit. If they're water tube, they're going to scale out on the side closest to the heat. But we've been taught for years, how many heard the term black gold? How many of you grew up thinking black gold?
I mean, it's gold, it's good.
The first time I heard it, the guy says, oh yeah, if you do a boiler retrofit, take the boiler out, put it in a drum, change your boiler, and then put the old water back in. How many of you would do that if you bought a brand new truck, take all the fluids from your old truck and put it in your new one and drive it away? Anybody? So, it's a myth that has been around forever. There are good companies changing that. They're here. Have a look. The second side of this.
The second one in here. That's all I got.
Back up. There we go.
There you go.
So there's the black water. The black water we're talking about. This isn't your father or your grandfather's boiler anymore. Right? These passageways are small, compact. The condensate is acidic. We are seeing problems. The manufacturers were nice in the beginning. They're not giving you warranty anymore. Black water is sludge. It's corrosion. It's magnetite. It starts the minute you fill your boiler, even on nice, new, clean installs.
All right, so moving along. This one, I want some honesty on this one, okay? Because I'm not sure if I'm going to get it or not. Because I think everyone knows the answer, but it's a matter of not as whether or not you're doing the right thing. We all treat our condensate and neutralize it. What have you got? All right, it's a good mix. I think I see some red cards. I think that's the honest one, okay? And, you know, we just want to talk a bit about this. You know, the one nice thing about all this condensing equipment is we extract that latent heat out of the flue gas, and that byproduct we get is all this water called condensate. And so when we look at it, what do we do with it? Oh, we just throw it down the drain. But the point is, this is actually acidic, and it can cause problems in your boiler if it's not properly managed to drain out of the boiler, or it can cause problems within the actual drainage system of the building, the house, or the municipality. Because when you look at it, I don't know if everyone truly understands how much condensate is actually generated by a boiler. And to give you an idea, is for every 100,000 BTUs per hour, that boiler will produce how much condensate? Any guesses? Anyone? We'll do a very low temperature, okay? When we look at a low temperature, right? Okay, you know, if the condensing boiler's at a high temperature, it's not really condensing. But, you know, if we go to a low temperature, then we got a lot of condensate, and it's a gallon, 1 gallon per hour. So you put a million BTU boiler, it's working the hardest at night at like probably like 4 to 6 in the morning, and you're dumping 10 gallons an hour of acid into the actual drain. Not good. But if it doesn't leave your boiler, that's an even bigger problem, because I don't know if anyone's seen things like this, where we've all learned coffee grounds, right? Things in there that's on the combustion side of the boiler. If you can't get the condensate out of it, where it recirculates, and when it does that, it becomes more and more acidic. It becomes more and more acidic at each heat exchanger, more and more and more. So you should be treating your condensate that leaves your equipment.
You should have one more. Perfect. Okay, let's do it again. I don't need to treat city water. It's already been treated. If you pay taxes, they do what? They treat the water, right? How many agree? That's a fact.
Again, be honest.
All right.
Be honest.
Have you guys been to this class before? Okay, it is false. It is a myth. City water, well water, it's not treated. There's no protection. It typically has high electrical conductivity, which helps in the breakdown of all your metals. All right, water is known as a universal solvent. Even though you think it's okay to drink, it actually can cause some damage. Not so much to you, but to your boiler system. The water will stabilize, but the hard ions will precipitate out on your heat exchanger, causing damage. Aggressive salts will break up the film that's on there. Just using H2O is a no-no. They didn't even get that one. So, sludge, lime scale buildup, rust deposits, we get lots of it. Three types of corrosion. First one Brian just talked about from the condensate. But then we've got the inside or the water side of your area, which can be, if you look at that little piece that right underneath inside, you can take a hammer and chisel to that. I mean, it's virtually cement. Fire tubes, I used to think they were great because, you know, they were self-cleaning. Is that the word we used?
Self-cleaning is what we said.
Yeah.
Many said.
Yeah. However, you can see they still clog up. So you have galvanic and oxidation corrosion of the metals on the fire side and inside. Don't think it's just happening in one place. And the scale side, a little bit of scale, 1/16 of an inch is like reducing your output by 12%. Right? You just put in a high-efficient boiler, but you didn't deliver a high-efficient system. And of course, the bigger they are, the harder the water, the less you service them, that number will climb as high as 30% plus reduction in heat output.
Next one. You don't need to worry about treating your system if it's all just copper, baseboard, or PEX. What do you think of that one? Myth or fact? Oh, good. Excellent. Because when we look at it, in any hydronic system, we're mixing everything together in there. We've got copper. We've got potentially steel. You know, even if you've got a nice in-floor system installed, you've got some PEX. You've got some brass ball valves. You've got all kinds of things going on in that system. And as that water is flowing through it, it is going to capture something from all that stuff, and it's going to go somewhere. And chances are it's going to run right through the heart of that system, which is your boiler. And that's why it's really, really important that it doesn't matter to say, hey, you know what? I have 5,000 feet of PEX in here and like a couple of feet of copper. I don't need to worry about it. Well, you do, because even in brand new systems, it doesn't take long and you'll see the discoloration in that water, or you'll see the discoloration in the glycol. And it's one of those things that when you go back 1 month, 2 months, 4 months later, it's going to look a lot different. So as you mix all these dissimilar metals and all these dissimilar products together and polymers, it doesn't mean you're off scot-free. You still got to make sure that you take the time to treat your boiler water.
All right. Demineralized, deionized, or reverse osmosis water. They're all the same, right? And we don't need to add any more treatment. Come on, we can't even hook you on a green here? Like, all right. Again, you guys are correct. It's a good start to be using better quality water than what comes out of your tap, but it's not the only thing you get to do, right? They will remove some of the aggressive salts like chloride, sulfates, and nitrates, which will attack stainless, copper, and aluminum. And if we still have some steel boilers out there, it'll go after them as well. By removing the scale-producing hard ions, you lower the conductivity, less conductive, slowing of the process. All right, but it's an ongoing process. You're always checking. Demineralized water is not new. It's been around 15 years in Europe. something we should be doing here. Water will self-alkalize and naturally goes up above 8 in the pH scale, which you're about to see shortly. So the main ways we can do this, tap water, softened water with chemical treatment, or demineralized. There are different layers that you can do to treat your boiler water. And they're not expensive. Everybody asks me how much. Well, it's not expensive. Soft water equals less scale, but higher corrosion and magnetite due to higher conductivity of the water. Soft water and chemical is better, but you now have to test and maintain. And demineralized water is a good start, but you still add inhibitors and you test annually to maintain your system.
A little bit of glycol will protect my boiler system. You know, so I just put a bit in. You know, I don't need too much, just a little bit. It'll be good. Okay? Lots of red, a couple of greens. That is, in fact, a no-no for sure. It's really, really important. Everyone says glycol will protect the system, but it has to be in the right percentage amounts. Okay? And when you look at it, when you're adding glycol, and, you know, I think as an industry we say, you know, polypropylene is the better way to go over ethylene, just out of a toxicity standpoint. But even the glycols will have a lot of stuff in them as well. But if you don't have a mixture that's very, very high, then that water is going to break down and other things are going to happen to that water, which is going to be really, really bad. So if you look here, we show the pH scale with some really good examples of where things are. And does anyone know what pH even stands for? It stands for potential hydrogen. So what's the potential of the hydrogen? If there's too much in the water, right, so we get a higher rating, you know, then what's going to happen is there's a lot of solids in the water and solids and everything are going to come up as you heat them out. If it's not very high at all, it becomes more and more acidic. And as a result, you know, you're going to have things that are going to eat away at things like your heat exchanger, things like your condensate, which you can see we show flue gas condensate in there having a pH level between, you know, 2 and 5.5. And that's one of the reasons why you actually have to treat it. So it's very, very important that, you know, when you're testing your boiler water, you want it to be between 6.5 and 8.5. That's the range you want to see your system at, okay? And it's not hard to do. I mean, a lot of manufacturers will offer testing of systems. You know, if you have a glycol in, a lot of the glycol manufacturers will test your system, tell you the percentage of how much glycol you have in there, and let you know, you know, where it sits, if it's still active, if it's treating the system very, very well. You know, otherwise with water, you can take your water testing to a bunch of different people, but you want to make sure you're testing for things like the pH level, the dissolved solids. You know, those are the things, the hardness of the water. Those are the things you want to make sure that you see in that system because it is going to change over the year. You know, when we look at it, and if you have a boiler system that's just hooked up to a city feed, we already talked about treating that water, but no one really puts a meter on their feed. So as it sits there for 12 months, if there's a leak in there, do you even know? Do you know how much fresh water has come into that boiler system? And if a bunch of fresh water is coming in, chances are it hasn't been treated. So that's why it's one of those important things that you always got to make sure that you go back and check that out, okay? Because pH is a very, very important indicator of what's going on in the bloodlines of your hydronic system, okay? So when we look at glycol and percentages, I mean, right now, you gotta be really careful on where you are as well on glycol levels as well. You know, you wanna make sure that it's high enough that it's gonna protect and low enough that it's not too little. And that range is typically in the neighborhood of around 35% to 50%. Depending where you are, where your coldest temperature is, to what you wanna do to make sure you have that adequate safety, 35% to 50% is where you wanna be. Because over 50%, that becomes a bigger problem of trying to move it through the hydronic system. When you get that jelly type material to move it through, and it's a problem for the pumps and everything else like that. And not enough, as I said, it can actually have more harm on that system versus really helping it out.
All right. Inhibitors alone will provide adequate protection from corrosion. Come on, everybody play the game. This is how you stay awake after lunch. A miss again. Oh, no, wait, I saw that green card. Okay, we got one guy on my side. I thought they'd work. I believed it. Inhibitors will deplete over time. Although I have listened to a U.S. seminar where the salesman guaranteed me you only had to put it in once. It was guaranteed for the life of the system. Apparently it's not. It's part of the solution. Corrosion is natural and ongoing, and it starts the minute you put the water in. So just for fun, I did a little test at home because I had heard this from another rep, and I went, okay, people always have little gimmicks. Let's try it out. Two jars of water, turn the tap on, put water in each one, took some fresh, brand new steel wool. I mean, it looked like it was stainless, but it wasn't. It was just steel wool. Ripped a little hunk off, threw it in the water. The water on the left, my left, your left, right? Just water, just that steel wool. On the right, same thing, except two drops of inhibitor. After 90 minutes, you can already see the process. After 150 minutes, that's what I was seeing. I just let them sit on the counter. I didn't heat them up. I didn't want to advance the corrosion. But then I gave the jar a little shake, the one that already had the stuff in it. You can see the goodies that are floating around. Oop, there's the last one. So there's 2 days. I did run them a little longer. The neat thing was the one without the two drops of inhibitor, you could see that film on the bottom, that rusty film. I mean, that's how quick this stuff reacts. So the proof was there. Two little drops, it helps. But again, it's not the only piece. You still need to start with good quality water. Mr. Bryan.
Air and dirt separators, with or without magnets, were originally designed for air removal on the supply side of your hydronic system. What do you think? A little uncertain on this one. I see some green. Okay, I was like, okay, green's the way. I see some red. Okay. All right, so when we look at this one, this is an interesting one to talk about. We might spend a little more time on this because, as we say, air and dirt separators, with or without magnets, were originally designed for air removal on the supply side of the system. So, you are correct. But one of the issues we're seeing is, actually, not one of the issues, these are some of the issues we're seeing. I was talking to one of the pump manufacturers, and he brought this up as well. He's like, you know, I'm seeing some pump seals leaking. I'm seeing, you know, circulators seizing, zone valves getting hung up, low water cutoffs are getting all fouled up. Plugged heat exchangers. What's creating all that? Well, what we've learned is we've got to do a better job of how we look after the actual particles that are in there. So, when we look at the size of particles that are in a system, and this is maybe a little bit hard to read, but, you know, they can get microscopic in size, but as they build up, that's what's becoming more and more of an issue in our hydronic systems. Because what they're going to do is they're going to attach themselves to the inside of the heat exchanger or to the magnet in those pumps. And as a result, what ends up happening is that causes a disruption on how well those pieces of equipment are able to fire, transfer heat, and over time it's going to clog them up. Now, Jeff, did you want a couple of minutes to talk on the particle size as well?
So this is the one case, guys, where size matters, okay? Come on, Tim, that's a good one. Yeah, so it's microscopic. It's invisible to the naked eye. If you look on there, they're showing you one strand of hair is about 70 micron, but the diameter of a piece of magnetite is between 2 and 8 microns. You can't see it. But a small particle size also means that a small amount covers a large area. 1 gram of magnetite will cover an area about 3/4 of a square meter, about the size of a 24 inch by 36 inch panel rad, which of course, you know, you'll probably see here somewhere. Magnetic filtration is independent of particle size. That's why the solutions aren't just one piece.
And you're starting to see a lot of it in some of the manuals from some of the boiler manufacturers. You'll see more and more of them that are talking about this. And they're actually making the suggestion, and in certain areas, it is code where you actually have to put in some form of magnetic filtration. And then to give you an idea how serious this is, this next picture shows you basically some of the sediment that is coming out of our hydronic systems. One of these was actually from a hospital in the UK where they put this on the inlet. It's actually, I think, on their heat exchanger, not their boiler. So if you sat there and you looked at a plate-to-plate heat exchanger and you looked at the profile of it and how tight those are, can you imagine that amount of sediment building up inside those heat exchangers? You want to make sure that you're preventing that from going in. So that's why it's so important. Although we have our air separator on the supply side, we want to put our magnetic filtration on the return side before it goes back into the boiler and before it goes through our pumps. And that's one of the best ways we're going to be able to protect it.
I just like this picture because you can't see magnetite unless you put a magnet in there. Then you can see it. The next one's yours too.
So, what's the solution? We've talked about all these myths or facts. You guys, most of you did pretty good, but I think some of you learned from everyone else in the room and went with the flow, but that's okay. But what's the solution? Well, the most important thing to do is test, clean, maintain, and protect your hydronic system, okay? So part of your service you should be doing on an annual basis is testing your boiler water, maintaining it, cleaning it out with filtration and cleaning all that stuff and making sure you're adequately protecting it.
All right, so just to blow up on each of those, ensure adequate pump sizing, pump flow sizing. If you're running a water tube boiler, flow is critical. Read the free manual. They will tell you exactly which curve to use, which pump to put in. Fire tube boilers, everybody thinks, oh, I don't need as big a pump, that there's no big pressure drop. No, but that low flow creates lots of deposit spots for the debris if you're not protecting. Magnetic filtration, oh, where filters, strainers, they're great on the front end. They catch the big stuff. It's protecting the boiler and the boiler pump. So we always go to the return side. And if you don't believe me, put one on a job where you think you're protected up front. Just throw one on one of your jobs, good customer, and go back in a year and pull the magnet out. And if it's blank, okay, I owe you a filter. But if it's full of junk, you know the front end isn't protecting the back end. Boiler feed, treat your water. You can start with very simple demineralized water. You could buy the water. I mean, that gets a little bit expensive. But if you have a big old system and you know there's water leakage, you've always got makeup water, you want to do an automatic demineralized makeup water system. What's the point of putting in good water and then anytime new water goes in, it's just plain tap water? And use corrosion scale inhibitor. You saw what a little bit will do in conjunction with everything else. Every time you add fresh water, you add new oxygen. Test annually, and again, RTFM. And we're almost on time, buddy.
It's amazing.
God, and this is our first time doing this. Okay, so here's our options with the water we're gonna put in, or glycol. And you'll see, if you buy pre-mixed glycol, you'll see that they're using demineralized water. Otherwise, the inhibitors fix the problem of your water and then don't protect your boiler. So, untreated water, we've talked enough. The corrosion is going to happen all the time. Softened water, you still get corrosion. Although you've removed some of the stuff, you've increased the conductivity, you're still going to get corrosion. Demineralized water with inhibitors, from what I have seen, read, and talked to the pros, is kind of the way to go. Your job is to assess the risk level profile of your water in your system. You're the guys in charge, you're the experts, you're the ones selling your service to your customer. Give them the best value for the money. Our industry has changed a lot. I've been in this, unfortunately, since 1989. I've had a good run, and I've watched it change. I've watched trends come and go, but the technology changes every day. We have to keep up. Don't think of this as another expense, another cost to your customer. Think of it as profitability for your business. Make this a profit center. Explain to your customer why.
And the big thing about this, I mean, this fall, you're going to get calls from your customers to go start up their equipment, or you're going to get calls because their equipment's not working, and you're going to have a look at that water now and have a look and test it and see what's going on. There's no hocus pocus here. You can show the owner what's going on. You can show that you're properly maintaining that system. So I really encourage you to keep this in your mind that there are products and there are people that can support you on this to show you, if you're not familiar on the things you should be doing, to make sure that the boiler chemistry you have in your hydronic system is operating at peak efficiency for that boiler and for that system and for your customer. Because the last thing you want to do is show up on a service call and have it look like this. Okay? Especially if you're going to be doing boiler retrofits. When you sit there and look at, you go to that nice house that's been there for 80 years with steel pipe running through the whole house, and you rip out this boiler that has ports, you know, the size of my head, and you're going to put it in this new condensing boiler that's a little hot rod, and then you're going to take all that sludge and put it right through that heat exchanger. So you want to make sure you're managing that system properly and that system is going to operate as efficiently as you want it to and as it's designed to. All right? So I'd like to thank you for your time today. HPAC Magazine, thanks for inviting Jeff and I, as big competitors that we are, to prove that we can get on stage together and be friends for 45 minutes. And we really appreciate you guys listening and your participation today. So thank you very much.